Films of the Future by F.W. Murnau. McCall's Magazine, September 1928. Have the films of future far beyond our dreams? Will pretty screen stars pass and real people take their place? And will the movies end war? Perhaps the answer may be found in the present great revolution in Hollywood, a struggle that is changing the style in stars, stories, and technique. Murnau, one of the leaders, tells here of his hope. What is the future of motion pictures? Alas, I am not an oracle. If I could answer you, I would be, perhaps, the most important man in the world, for the screen has as great potential power as any other existing medium of expression. Already it is changing the habits of mankind, making people who live in different countries and speak different languages neighbors. In the future, it may educate our children's children even better than books. It may put an end to war, for men do not fight when they understand each other's heart. I am of the opinion that as a world force, the screen has possibilities beyond imagining. It is very strange to me that we have a generation born and grown to manhood since the motion pictures were invented. And yet so far, no great poet of the new art has arisen. All great arts have had great artists born to understand them as no other men can, and the motion picture is the single art expression of our age. Do you smile at that and think, this man Murnau is a foreigner, and all foreigners are a little odd? But when a genius in expressing the heart and soul through that tiny strip of celluloid comes to us someday, you shall see that I am right in calling the motion pictures an art. Such a one is growing among you now, perhaps many such. For singers know more about song than silent men. A painter must be born and not made. And there will be great geniuses of the screen who will know instinctively what the motion pictures can do, that no other art form can do. Now we must use novels, stage plays, short stories, history, as a basis for our film plots. But in the future, scenario writers will think screen ideas and dream screen dreams. The directors of the future will realize that the motion picture is a separate art that has nothing in common with the stage, and can express fine shades of thought and feeling that are impossible to the spoken drama. When this poet of the pictures comes to Hollywood, he will not be met at the station by bands and flowers. He may have a hard time getting by the studio gatemen, and a harder time convincing the makers of the movies that he can show them something new and worth their while. That is natural. Always men have shrunk from the idea of change. But when he does make his way inside the studio gates, he will find someone at last who will listen to him. And from that moment, the motion pictures will change, until perhaps we shall hardly recognize them as the same things we make so clumsily today. For many years, the movies, as I have learned to say since I am in America, have not developed a great deal. People said, we must do this and that because we have always done this and that. The audiences learned exactly what to expect. Pictures in the past have too often been made by a formula, so much of scenery, so much lovemaking, the good rewarded, the villain punished, everything finished off very neatly. Too often, pictures have made the world banal, instead of revealing new heights and depths in life. One would think to look at them that there were only beautiful women in the world, and young men with broad shoulders and flashing eyes. I think that pictures of the future will show persons rather than screen personalities, humanity instead of popular movie stars. In Sunrise, some of the critics were severe with me because of the ugly two-colored wig I allowed Janet Gaynor to wear. They complained that it extinguished her beauty and made her almost plain. They did not guess that that was exactly what I was trying to do. I wished Janet to play, not Janet Gaynor, the screen beauty, but a poor, stupid little peasant girl. I had to submerge her physical beauty to emphasize the beauty of her heart. It was a difficult thing, trying to suppress that little actress's loveliness. But to me, beauty is not going to be the chief requisite of the stars of the future. They must photograph well, naturally, but it is their sympathy, their understanding of the heart, and their ability to show that understanding that will be important. The chief change they made in the movies for a while was to spend more money, and then still more money, on pictures. Big sets, elaborate historical costumes, mob scenes, the destruction of property, spectacles, epics. they advertised as the great reason for going to see their picture, "It cost $1 million," until people perhaps came to feel that they were not being treated fairly unless they saw a city burned down, or 5,000 extras all in wigs and costumes on the screen at the same time. That, I firmly believe, is not what the pictures of the future will have to do. I think that audiences are getting tired of crowded sets and involved plots. It is like eating too much cake. I think they would like to see something simple and real. I think that in the film of the future, the story itself will be more important than splendid sets and costumes. One of my dreams is to make a motion picture of 6 reels, with a single room for setting, and a table and chair for furniture. The wall at the back would be blank. There would be nothing to distract from the drama that was unfolding between a few human beings in that room. Someday, I shall make that picture. The motion picture of the future will not cost so much. It is the mechanical end of picture making now that is holding us back. 40% of a director's time is spent on getting the machinery of the studio arranged as he wishes. By the time he comes to the actual making of the scene, where he needs all his creative ability, all his power of the imagination, he is already tired from his struggles with wood and iron and canvas. The camera, that is different. They have experimented with the camera. It will do many strange and fine things now, almost as much as I can ask of it. But one must keep a large and expensive cast waiting for hours while the lights are moved about. Then, when at last the scene is being made, perhaps a tiny bulb blows out, or a screw comes loose, and there is a $5,000 a day cast held up again while the trouble is repaired. The present machinery of the studios will not be enough for the director of the future. Even now, I ask that they make me a special equipment so that I can get my camera where I want it. The picture I am working on now is a circus story, and naturally the camera must not stand stock still in one spot in such a gay place as a circus. It must gallop after the equestrians, it must pick out the painted tears of the clown, and jump from him to a high box to show the face of the rich lady thinking about the clown. So I have had them build me a sort of traveling crane with a platform swung at one end for the camera. My staff has nicknamed it the Go Devil. The studios will all have Go Devils someday, to make the camera mobile. They say that I have a passion for camera angles, but I do not take trick scenes from unusual positions just to get startling effects. To me, the camera represents the eye of a person, through whose mind one is watching the events on the screen. It must follow characters at times into difficult places, as it crashed through the reeds and pools and sunrise at the heels of the boy, rushing to keep his tryst with the woman of the city. It must whirl and peep and move from place to place as swiftly as thought itself, when it is necessary to exaggerate for the audience the idea or emotion that is uppermost in the mind of the character. I think the films of the future will use more and more of these camera angles, or as I prefer to call them, these dramatic angles. They help to photograph thought. I think that someday in the near future, there will be many different kinds of movie theaters, just as there are many kinds of theaters of spoken plays. There will be houses that show films made especially for young people. There will be others devoted entirely to talking pictures. There will be places where the program picture of today will be shown, intended only to entertain and amuse. And there will also be theaters, not very many perhaps, but a few in every city, where the very highest type of films may be seen, and where nothing else will be shown. The Chinese have an ancient proverb, "A picture is worth 10,000 words." Yet I think that this new invention, the talking picture, is here to stay. Those who saw that great drama of the air, Wings, at the early previews without the movie tone attachment, and later at the regular performance with the roar of the motors, the whir of wings, the tattoo of machine guns, will admit that the sounds increased the intensity of the action. There will be, before long, motion pictures in which the characters speak their lines from beginning to end. Perhaps before these words are printed, you will see such a picture on the screen. In some ways, the spoken words will hamper the pictures. For one, the action will be slower, for one can represent a long conversation by pantomime in a few feet of film. I do not think that all pictures will become talking pictures. There will be silent drama as now, except that it will have developed into its perfect form, a film without a written title. Pictures may be made understandable without captions which interrupt the rush of the drama. I have proved that myself. The Last Laugh had only one title when it was shown abroad, and I have never heard of anyone who did not understand its meaning. Color pictures are another future development of the screen. There will be occasional movies in natural colors, just as there are tinted prints to put upon your walls, as well as etchings. There will be other technical changes in the next 10 or 20 years. The three-dimension movie will be the usual thing, instead of the occasional effect. I produced an appearance of depth in the marsh sequence of Sunrise by a trick arrangement of lights and shadows. Other directors have experimented with sets in which the floors rise and fall, and the lines of door, ceiling, and furniture slant sharply according to the laws of perspective. But there is a simpler and less expensive device already in preparation, which I may not explain now, but which will produce the same illusion of depth and distance as the old-fashioned stereopticon slides. Perhaps, too, there will be a radical change in the way motion pictures are projected. I understand one producer is experimenting in a method of showing a picture without a screen, so that it looks as though the characters themselves were present in the room in which the audience sits. Television and the radio may bring the movies of the future through the air into your own home at the turn of a key. But to me as a director, the most interesting difference between the motion picture of today and that of tomorrow lies not in the mechanics of the studio or theater, but in the treatment of stories and the work of players. They call me a mental director, by which they mean that I try to make the players understand the minds of the characters they are asked to portray, so that they will know their very thoughts. I talk to an actor of what he should be thinking, rather than what he should be doing. I do not merit such a high-sounding name as mental director. I am feeling my way as we are all doing, among the rapid changes that are coming into the motion pictures. No one really knows how to make pictures yet. I do not know how to make pictures. Developments of the future will make our present-day efforts appear as the play of children, as the stuttering of an unsure tongue.